Let's start chapter 6, that is tropical infections and infestations. It deals mostly with the surgical infection and infestations. First is amoebiasis, which is caused by anti-amoeba histolytica, and the mode of infection is fecal oral route. In pathogenesis, we have to know that it goes into the gut via the cyst form, and in the small bowel the cyst hatches, and in the colon the entire amoeba forms flask shaped ulcer, and then it goes through the portal circulation to the liver and causes amoebic liver abscess. It most commonly occurs in the right lobe of the liver. The explanation of that is because the blood from the superior mesenteric vein runs on a straighter course to the portal vein into the larger lobe. Therefore, it most commonly occurs in the liver. And important points for this is bloody mucoid diarrhea, also known as amoebic dysentery, is the most common symptoms, and it might also present with any upper abdominal symptoms like fever, malaise, etc. Any liver mass may also cause respiratory symptoms, and sometimes the mass in the cecum may lead to amoeboma, but we must rule out the colon cancer. And the ulcer can be seen by either flexible or rigid sigmoidoscopy, in which the flask shaped ulcer is seen. Now, outside endemic areas we can use serological tests, but it is mostly positive in the endemic areas. So for that we have to use mainly ultrasound and CT. It's quite helpful for the hepatitis. And for the treatment, medical treatment is effective. Mostly metronidazole is used. And for large abscess we have to aspirate along with the drug treatment, and surgical treatment is required only if there is complication. Sometimes the liver abscess goes into the peritoneal, pericardial or pleural cavities, and intestinal complication includes acute toxic megacolon and hemorrhage, and these may require resection, and initially exteriorization is required, and after that it may require subtotal colectomy and terminal ileostomy. That is it about amoebiasis. Next, we move on to the roundworm caused by Ascaris lumbricoides. It is also through the fecal oral route, in which when the eggs are ingested, then larva goes throughout the body. It has a pretty complex life cycle. From the intestine, it goes to the circulation, to in the lungs, and from the lungs, it goes to the systemic route via alveoli. The alveoli gets coughed up and then goes through the esophagus and through the small intestine, and so in the lungs it can cause pulmonary symptom that is known as Loeffler syndrome. That causes dry cough, chest pain, shortness of breath and fever, and in the intestine it might grow to a large size, so cause obstructive symptoms, and it can cause iron deficiency anemia and malnutrition, failure to thrive, abdominal pain, etc. Sometimes it might go to the bile duct and causes the obstructive jaundice, goes to the pancreas causing pancreatitis. Now, investigation for roundworm is mainly the eosinophils will be raised, and then stool examination may show the ova or parasite, and we can do the sputum or bronchoscopic washing for sarcotyledon crystals or the larva. And in Loeffler syndrome, the chest radiograph may show the exudations, and then we can see the worm sometimes in the ultrasound in bile duct or pancreatic duct. CT can be helpful in obstruction cases in which the curvilinear shadow is seen, as we see in this. So treatment for this is mainly self-limiting, and mostly intestinal drug is anti-helminthic drugs, mainly albendazole. But we must be careful because sometimes the death of the worms may lead to a ball of worms, and it may lead to the intestinal obstruction. So conservative treatment should be well monitored, and if there is complications then we have to do surgical treatment. And like perforation etc. requires laparotomy. And now we've seen lots of this much of roundworms is seen in a single patient. So next we have got Asiatic cholangiohepatitis caused by Clonorchis sinensis, a type of liver fluke, mostly found to the fish, and it mostly invades the intrahepatic bile ducts and causes dilation of the bile ducts, and sometimes forms stone in the gallbladder or bile duct. For diagnosis is mainly ultrasound, and its risk is mainly of cholangiocarcinoma. So if the patient is subclinical, we must treat them also. For definitive diagnosis, stool examination for wax, eggs and worms is necessary. That is it. Treatment is mainly medical. Medical treatment, praziquantel and albendazole is used. Surgical treatment means if it is in the gallstone, then cholecystectomy, exploration of CVD and some form of bypass between the gallbladder, biliary tract and the intestine, like pileo-jejunal, choledochojejunal synostomy. That's it. Next important tropical disease is filariasis caused by Uchereria bancroftii, and in some cases it is also caused by Brugia malai and Brugia timori. The diagnosis is made mainly through the microfaria, which is mostly seen in the night blood. So night time between 12 a.m. to 4 a.m. it is said the blood should be taken. And clinical appearances, it causes mainly lymph, invades the lymph vessel and causes lymphedema. Initially only a little bit of swelling is seen, and chronically it may lead to elephantiasis and mostly affect the lower limbs. It can also lead to chyluria, chylasiasis, and it causes tropical pulmonary eosinophilia, in which there is dry cough and it affects the respiratory tract. So the treatment is mainly diethyl carbamazine, and surgical procedures are done if there is huge elephantiasis or penile elephantiasis, scrotal elephantiasis. For hydrocele, excision and eversion of sac is done. This is the case of filariasis, leg and the scrotum and penis. Next we have to move on to the hydatid disease. In hydatid disease, it is caused by Echinococcus granulosus, called the dog tapeworm, and it is mostly common in sheep farmers. Though dog is the definitive host, human is the accidental host, and sheep is the intermediate host. The life cycle occurs by when we ingest the eggs from the dog feces. If we came into contact with the dogs, we ingest them. It forms the cyst in our body, but the cyst cannot mature into adult form in our body. But if the dog ingests the sheep meat, then the cyst form can grow into the adult form inside the dog. Now, cyst is composed of three layers. Pericyst is caused by the host inflammatory response. Ectocyst is the island layer, which is non-infective. And endocyst consists of the germinal epithelium and the protoscolosis. Now, the classification which we see here is WHO informal group, working group on echinococcosis. It proposed an ultrasound classification based on the status of activity of cyst. There are three groups. Group 1 means active group, means the cyst is larger than 2 cm and fertile. Group 2 is transition group, in which the cyst is starting to degenerate and entering into a transitional stage. So it is an intermediate group. It may contain viable protoscolices. And the group 3 is inactive group, which contains degenerative, partially or totally calcified cyst. So there is no need of requirement for this group. Clinical feature is, if it occurs mostly in the liver and sometimes in the lungs. In the liver, mostly the symptoms will be of swelling, sometimes right abdominal pain, and sometimes asymptomatic and discovered on ultrasound or CT. And pressure lesion is mostly caused by this wherever it is present. So sometimes it might present acutely as a form of anaphylactic shock when the fluid inside the cyst is released. So CT is the main best imaging technique. For treatment, we have medical treatment is generally can be used if it before the aspiration of the cyst. And we use mainly the PAIR technique, that is puncture, aspiration, injection and re-aspiration. Medical treatment is used before and after this. In the drugs, we give for some certain period of time, 3 weeks of drug with 1 week of rest. And next, we have to use scolicidal agents in this. That is, scolicidal agents are alcohol, and then we have betadine, or povidone iodine, and hypertonic saline. So that is it. Next is pulmonary hydatid disease, which is quite rare. And the important feature of this in CT is water lily sign. Next is leprosy, not so much usable in surgery. Now, it is caused by Microbiota leprae, as we know, and it causes various types of deformity which are important for surgery, like we see here the nasal bridge collapse, and then eye changes due to paralysis of orbicularis oculi, loss of eyebrows. We see the claw hand and we see the claw toes. We also see the trophic ulcer due to the anesthesia, and we also see leonine facies with gynecomastia in the man. So the treatment is mainly through the medical treatment, 3 drugs, mainly dapsone, and then clofazimine and rifampicin is used. And surgical reconstruction for the different claw hand and other procedure like tendon transfer, nerve transfer, etc. are done. Next we move on to mycetoma. Mycetoma means it is a granulomatous disease which expresses mainly the skin, subcutaneous tissue and deeper structures. It is caused by mainly either fungi, in which it is called eumycetoma, or actinomyces, it is called actinomycetoma. The triad, important triad for this is the subcutaneous mass, multiple sinuses and seropurulent discharge. And it is mostly present in the mycetoma belt, mostly around the equator. So if the patient from this area presents with painless subcutaneous mass, multiple sinus and seropurulent discharge, then we have to think of mycetoma. Here we see this, and it can be present in any structure like hand, knee, head and neck, etc. Multiple sinuses are seen in this. It spreads only locally and may also affect the bone, so you must differentiate it from tuberculosis. Its pathognomic finding in CT scan is called dot in circle sign. And in for histopathological diagnosis, we require the specimen with the grain, that is grain produced by these organisms. Then that is it. Medical treatment according to the cause. If it is the fungus, then we must use ketoconazole, itraconazole or voriconazole. For the actinomyces, we use amikacin and cotrimoxazole. Surgical treatment is required if this cannot work, and it requires wide excision or amputation may also be required. Next tropical disease is poliomyelitis. Though vaccine has been developed for many years, it is also present in some tropical diseases countries, and management according to the paralysis, multidisciplinary treatment is required. Important new tropical disease is tropical chronic pancreatitis. It affects mainly the people of the low socioeconomic status. It is thought that people who eat the cassava, which is the root vegetable, which contains cyanide, if it is not detoxified properly, then it might lead to this tropical chronic pancreatitis. And it causes the dilation of pancreatic ducts with the presence of large interductal stones and fibrosis of pancreas as well. Now, it also causes diabetes, and the diabetes is said to be fibrocalculus pancreatic diabetes, as we see here. The disease is quite common in this area and aptly describes the changes which occur in this disease, and this requires insulin therapy. And we see the in X-ray CT, we see lots of calcification throughout the pancreas. And treatment is mainly exocrine support of the enzymes, diabetes treatment, and nutrition treatment. And if there is intractable pain, then we might have to use surgery. Next important disease is tuberculosis. In tuberculosis, the two most important point in for surgery is tubercular cervical lymphadenitis and small intestinal tuberculosis. In cervical lymphadenitis, if we see the cold abscess in a cervical lymph node, then we must rule out the tuberculosis. Now, in this, the lymph nodes are matted, and in later stage may be cystic, denoting an abscess. The abscess denotes underlying caseation and does not show feature of inflammation. And ultimately, abscess may burst, leading to a sinus. Diagnosis mainly through the pus can be cultured made from the ZN stain. And treatment mostly medical. And surgical treatment is generally not required. If the abscess drainage etc. is required, then surgeon may be called upon. The current investigation includes gamma interferon, and these all are better studied in medicine. Now, tuberculosis of the small intestine is mainly two types, ulcerative type and hyperplastic type. Ulcerative type is due to more virulent bacteria, mainly to ulcer and perforation. Hyperplastic is due to drinking the unpasteurized milk, so Mycobacterium bovis etc. causes the hyperplastic type, and it may lead to intestinal stricture and obstruction, and it might lead to also local areas of ascites. So patient may present with the weight loss, malaise, evening fever, cough, alternating constipation and diarrhea, intermittent abdominal pain with distension. Abdominal is quite doughy due to the ascites, and sometimes in resource poor settings, patient may present with intestinal obstruction. Peritonitis may also occur. In that investigation, we see the raised inflammatory markers, anemia, and positive sputum culture. Ultrasound may show ascites area. And then barium meal and follow through may show the strictures with subhepatic cecum. Treatment is mainly combined medical and surgical. So if there is any stricture, it might require resection. It might require exteriorization or resection and anastomosis. Anastomosis can generally be done if only after the proper healing of the patient and after the completion of the medical treatment. Second stage, sometimes a hemicolectomy is also required. And then we move on to the typhoid. In surgery, the importance of typhoid is for treatment of typhoid ulcer, which mainly occurs in second to third week. And if the patient has typhoid, suddenly start developing the abdominal pain, then we must rule out the peritonitis due to a typhoid ulcer. Treatment is mainly resuscitation first, antibiotics, and then laparotomy. And we can do either the repair of the perforation or sometimes anastomosis, exteriorization may also be required. That's it.